Hey, how you doing? It's me with the several names from Toronto. How you guys doing? And I'm eating. Just a salad. Nothing to get upset about. I'm here. Oh, get. Flies are trying to eat my food. Yeah, we got flies in here. I'm hot, but I can't turn on the air conditioning because I'm doing this video. Very serious video, and I really hope I have some black men respond to this. I'm really serious. I hope black men respond to this video that I'm about to do, because it's very serious. And I'll tell you the truth, I'm afraid to go outside. I'm afraid to leave my home. I even answer the phone and I get like all this animosity from like numbers from people I don't know asking for my name. Oh, wish I had a fan. Asking for me by my name, men being very hostile, and I don't know what the hell is going on. But I just want to stay in my room and go nowhere and do nothing. I don't have a regular fan, so this will have to do. Black men, this is for you. I'm listening to what all the black girls up here are saying and what all the black girls everywhere are saying. My collar is wet back there. Whatever. And something unholy is going on in our community. Just unholy that we have to address. And we being the weaker sex still. And those of us with children have to be extra concerned, because we have people who rely on us, are all scared. We're scared. We are females and we are scared because we are the weaker sex. We are physically weaker and we are vulnerable. And I don't understand. I don't understand why. I don't get it. Black men, you have to tell us. And not out of anger or rage. You have to break this down. You have to make us understand what is going on. And why you just, we don't matter. I don't know one woman who doesn't matter. I don't know one man who doesn't matter. We are broken, we are fractured like crazy. And I'm listening to women like, you know, Tanya TKO, who's been online a long time, and Cynthia G, and they are breaking it down in numbers. Like, they are coming up here with legitimate proof that something terrible is happening with black men against black women. And if there are good black men out there, you guys have to start. I'm hot. You guys need to start standing up. I see these militias, but what are you doing? I can tell you, when the Black Panther militia was a thing, they fed communities, they defended women, they stood up, and they were political, and they were in the mix, getting killed. You're still getting killed, but now you're doing nothing else but getting killed. And then completely abandoning us for women who you abandon anyhow, other women who are not black. So there's something going on here, black men, that you need to speak to. You need to speak to it. You can't just let this go, because you know what? You are at risk. You're putting us at risk. You're putting the children at risk, the whole community. Is tattered. And I'm going to give you a couple of, first I just want to say, my dad ruined me for all guys. It sounds kind of creepy, but I know I mean that really, because of the kind of person, I mentioned it before, the kind of person my dad and brothers are protectors. They're men who will pick up a hammer and build a house, and who love their children, who took care of their children, who hang on to jobs. Like, I don't know what's going on out here. Is it something in the water? Is it something in the food? Who is telling you what to make you think that we are the enemy? I know I'm not. I'm your consummate housewife type, stay home, look after, my son, my one son. I wanted five kids. I had five, but I lost four. But I'm not that woman, and I've been attacked. I'm going to talk about situations where I've been actually attacked by black men in the streets for no reason. When I say no reason, I mean no reason whatsoever. I don't get it. My dad was a protector. He was powerful. He was a man who wasn't afraid to cry, whatever. Like, he was all man. And again, so are my brothers. So I don't understand what is going on. It's up to you guys to speak. I don't have a big forum, but, you know, this little tiny itty-bitty forum here, like, if you see this, please comment. I want you to comment. I want you to tell us what is going on and why you feel the way you do. If you feel that we have abandoned you, or if we're offending you, you need to speak up. Because the world is changing quickly, and it is just eating the vulnerable. It's just mowing down the vulnerable, and we cannot continue to be the vulnerable by being so fractured. Let me tell you about the abuse that I suffered recently here, which makes me not want to even leave my house. First, I'm going to start with a guy who lives in my building. Man about my age, Jamaican guy. He used to be nice all the time and reason with me and talk politics and all this stuff and speak. He was a very educated man. And one thing led to the next, and then one day he knocked on my door, which is a no-no. I don't like when people knock on my door. I just really don't. I have to know you're coming. But anyhow, even family. But he knocked on my door, and I wasn't rude. And he said, why don't you come up to my place and smoke some weed and eat some food? I said, well, I don't smoke weed. I do eat, but, there's a pandemic. We're in the middle of a pandemic. So I don't think I want to do that right now, at least. He immediately went from being a normal type person to a beast, a savage. He said, why is it because of that MF-er in the room? Like, what are you talking about? Like, I thought he was talking about another man or something. No, your kid. This man attacked me because I wouldn't go out to his place, go up to his apartment, eat, and smoke drugs. Because I'm down here all up in my kid's business, in my son's business. You know, my son is 20. He's not a baby anymore. I don't have to babysit him. I don't need a babysitter for him. But my goodness, where was that coming from? I didn't understand where this guy was coming from with this bullcrap. This is not the only time that I have to worry about that guy in my building. I saw him, in fact, today. This happened months ago. I saw him today when I was on my balcony. He used to say hi, and this time he was talking to a white girl and looked up. I guess he wanted to give me the impression, like, to hell with you, whatever. Which is fine and well. I don't care because I don't want you. You know, like, I don't want anybody right now. And I wouldn't want you if you're the kind of person who thinks I'm going to just to hell with my son. My son has his life, and he's old enough for me to leave. But if you thought it was about my kid, then he was just way out of line. Another time, not long ago, I was in a store. Now, I buy this stuff, Tiger Malt. It's really good stuff. I love it. It's a Bajan malt drink. And the only place I can get it is in an Asian store, a Chinese store. So I went to the Chinese market and I got some of this stuff. I was pushing my cart and it was heavy because I had about six of those bottles and a bunch of, you know, whatever else things I had from before. And there was a black man who was, I believe he was younger than me. I'm pretty sure he was younger than me. And he was standing right in the way. The market was pretty full. And I said, excuse me, you know, cheerfully, whatever, basic excuse me. And he just stared at me. Now, he was wearing a mask, and people had these masks on. You don't really know what their expression is. But he just ignored me. And I said, well, maybe he just didn't hear me. I don't know. Well, I knew he heard me. Anyhow. I said, excuse me, please, can I get by? He went ballistic. He went nuts on me. You effing bees, you effing hoes are all the same, you black bees. And like, this place is full of Asians. And this stopped traffic. This guy was so aggressive and loud that like everybody was looking while he was screaming at me like this. There were other black people, and they just like saw it, black men, whatever, women, and they just looked away. I felt like I was in the Twilight Zone. I was like, I don't get this. Like, I just don't understand where this was coming from, where this animosity was coming from. I just remember looking down at his boots and seeing how nice they were, and I didn't want to run over them. I didn't want to scuff them, you know. Some brothers are about their footwear. Didn't want to scuff his boots, so I was careful not trying not to run over his boots. That's what I remember thinking. But that's not how he saw it. Like, he just saw me as being this horrible, evil woman that was worthy of cussing out and maybe even harming. So I just backed away and went another direction. Another time I was on the bus. And, you know, sometimes a seat above is raised so that the person's feet are at your back, the seat behind you. Anyhow, here in Toronto, that's how the buses are. So there's a little child with a woman behind me, and every now and then the child would kick the seat. I'm sure not to bug me, because the child must have been no more than 5 years old. So I said to the little girl, please stop, you know, be nice to children. I'm never rude to children because, you know, their attention span is short and they do things and they don't do them. You know, I didn't get the feeling the little girl was doing this out of any sort of malice. And she, a few moments later, she kicked again. I said, can you please stop? And, you know, she looked at me and I smiled at her. She smiled back. And she then started again and she looked at me. I asked her parent, the adult with her, can you please have the child stop doing that? I have a headache. And before I could say anything, a black man who was sitting across the way went nuts. He went ballistic on me. You black effing hoes, you black effing bees, it just went crazy. No matter where you go, you cause trouble, you get into people's faces. And he went nuts, so much so that it scared me. Like, this was not a boy. This was a grown man, like my age or whatever. Like, I mean, a big man, and a big man too. The bus is full of people, not mostly black, like just mixed, but not maybe one other black person. And they were all just, even the bus driver stopped, everybody stopped and was watching this man's tirade. And it was not only was it embarrassing, but it was frightening. So I decided, even with my headache and whatever, the weather that was raining, I just said, I'm just gonna get off the bus because I can see no one's gonna defend me. And this man's coming after me and I have no idea why he's coming after me, coming for me, whatever. And then there was another time, maybe about, I don't know, a few weeks ago again. I was in a store. I went to an Indian store where I buy incense, and they started selling these really derogatory ashtrays. Some made of pottery, and it's shellac pottery, and it's got a black man sitting lazily on the ashtray, and he's like black with big, huge red lips and a big joint hanging out of his mouth and big, lazy eyelids and, you know, a red, green, and gold tat on, sort of Jamaican. And there were a bunch of those ashtrays, and I asked the guy, the Indian guy working there, like, why are you selling these? This is derogatory. This is racist. Why did I do that? The Indians didn't even respond. The black guy, who was a really nice looking black guy, well, his eyes were nice and he was, you know, built, did the same thing. He went nuts on me. How dare I come into someone's store and insult them? I'm an effing bee, just a tirade. And there was a white guy who actually defended me. This was so sad, a white guy who actually defended me and said, yeah, you know, those are racist. But the black guy just went nuts on me. And how dare I come into the Indian man's shop and offend him? So he didn't see the merit in what I was trying to say. He didn't think it was, it was, you know, I'll tell you something. At that point, what I was thinking is just, I was like sort of, I couldn't get to the door. I didn't know what this guy was going to do. And like I said, he was quite buff. And so I was looking around at whatever jars, big glasses, sharp objects, just in case he came at me. Like, I'm thinking now I'm in survival mode because I don't know what this brother's going to do. This is what's going on out here. And Toronto never really used to be like a really hostile city like this. It was always sort of undercurrent. I mean, the racism was here because slavery and all that happened here, but it was never this thing. It was a time I remember when, you know, black people were glad to see each other on the street and hail each other up and stuff like this. But I don't remember all this hostility. Like, I just don't. I didn't come up with it in around my environment or my neighborhood, whatever. And I told you about my dad. You know, like, I just couldn't believe how abusive these men were. So yeah, you know. And yesterday I saw a really good-looking a nice looking black guy on the street. And I'll admit I did a double take, you know, and, you know, whoa, and smiled. And he looked at me like I was nuts. Like, what the F are you looking at? This is how he looked at me. And I was like, you know, I was just on my way out. So I was like, I don't know what to expect from black men anymore. Sorry, I'm eating a salad and I don't want any, have any green stuff in my teeth while I'm talking here. But anyhow, I don't know what to expect from black men anymore. But I know one thing, I've not been getting anything positive at all from you all. The media, the social media and the American media has distorted our who we are and our image so much so that it's just like it's permeated Canada. And this is all we get. All we see on TV and on social media now is swirling black men and women, and also gay, you know, the gayifying of a black man, the homosexuality making of a black man, which I always felt was not real. But also I've started to see black men around holding hands, which is something that, you know, like we have the gay community here. And when you go down into gay communities, you see gay people holding hands and stuff. But now it's like they're peppered everywhere, and you can't say hi to them. I've tried to, you know, smile, whatever. None of that. They just look at you as if you're the devil. It's like you made us do this or something. I don't know. But all I'm saying is like this really sucks. You know, I'm gonna. And I know that it's beyond widespread. I've got written a couple of notes written here. But where black men, it seems some of you have become suckers for white women, just suckers. Look at this case with Dante Wright and his brother hugging a white female cop who went into his apartment purposely and killed him, and he hugged her and forgived her. Like, this is the message we're getting. It's just not good. There's like no good can come of this. All people are seeing as weakness from our perspective, and black women not being protected, and black children not being protected. I know that because I have a child, well, now a young man. And, you know, if it wasn't for the fact that I literally sued like the school board and whatnot, you know, I would never get any justice. Nobody stood up for us. So Canadian black men, black people seem to be influenced by this over social media and in Hollywood and all of that. We're seeing all this stuff. You know, I also have to say this, like over 25% of black men now marry outside of the race, date outside of the race, as opposed to 10%, and actually 9% of black women. And then people say it's because there are a lot more men than women, but still, like, that doesn't excuse the fact that black men are in droves attacking us and coming out here against us, and I just don't get it. I don't know. I'm trying to think back to when it started, like when it became this big. Is there something in the water? Is there something in the food? What is it that is causing this? I just don't get it. And where these numbers are concerned, the quarter of black men dating outside of the race and marrying, once that black man accrues wealth, that those numbers go up. I might have said that in another video. Then like 30% of black men date outside of the race, marry outside of the race, thereby giving all the money back to the white man. That's what you're doing, giving all the money back into the community that hates you and that is working against you and that enslaved you and that continues to persecute you and hang your children. So I don't get it. Hip hop music, same thing. You know, there's a call for this romance again. People want the 90s again, and people are nostalgic about a different time when we used to slow dance and romance each other and date each other and like each other. But that's not what we're seeing. Like, and hip hop is touting this black vixen hoe type image of black women. And I can tell you something, okay? I know it's very easy to say, well, those women chose that. You know, those are broken women. Women don't go into these circumstances. Women don't become strippers and hookers and video vixens because they they were born and raised wanting to be that. These are women who are broken women. That's what they are. And a lot of men are even going dating women like that over, say, a woman who could be potential marriage material. I don't even think you all believe there is anything such as a Kim Porter type dating a woman who is marriage potential. And even Kim Porter experienced, you know what I'm talking about, and you, if you're watching, you know what I'm talking about. Even she was left with a baby. I know what that feels like because that's what my husband did. So, you know, you leave a woman with a baby, like, and then you go make other babies, then, you know, like, you're a bum. You're a bum. So the legacy, this legacy of demeaning black women in society is a patriarchal thing, too. You know, you talk about us, you know, like, we have to have our own. You got to have your own. Got to own what? Like, when you start getting pregnant, propagating the species, when you have no idea, obviously, what it's like to be pregnant and carry a pregnancy full term and then be a mother. I believe in women being in the home cooking and raising the kids and stuff, but that man has to be out there making the money and earning the bucks. And yes, I've always, I've always sort of worked online anyhow. And a lot of women can do that. I know a lot of women might not feel the way I do, but this is how I feel. Is that, you know, half the time I do these videos, it's always in the evening, like around this time, and I'm generally getting ready to cook for my son. And that's what I do. I cook, I bake, I do this stuff, I clean the house, you know, he could probably do a bit more work, get him to take the garbage out a little more often. But anyhow, yeah, society is a patriarchy, which has thrust women on our backs and made even having babies into like a medical minefield. You know, a medical money-making minefield against women, the patriarchy. So yes, pregnancy has become big pharma fodder, you know? We can't win. And yes, I understand when people like Tanya say, you know, I'm glad I'm child-free and single. You know, would I do this again? It's hard to say, because when you love your children unconditionally, if you love your children. And I do love my son very much, but to find, you know, if I were to do it all again, I wouldn't do it to him. I wouldn't do it to my son. I wouldn't bring him into this world, because it's very confusing for him. So when men start procreating, you can talk about she should have her own. Don't come into a situation thinking she's got to birth the babies and clean the house and cook all the food and rub your feet and your shoulders when you're tired and stuff and support all whatever you're doing and have the babies. On top, when you're not having the babies, like, you've got to be, come on, you've got to be the man, woman. That's how the universe, God, nature made it for us, male and woman. You have ego, we have hormones. They work very differently. They can work in tandem, but now it's just all blown out. I'm looking at some of these militias. I'm wondering, like, where are you guys at when people are being killed in the streets? When we talk about militias, the Black Panthers were out in the community, feeding people, fighting the power, like 100. This is what the Black Panthers and those so-called militia groups were doing and being killed for it. If you're going to be killed, I figured you might as well defend yourself. I'm kind of proud that Africa seems to be moving in a different direction than the West world, because it's a mess here. Canada, Toronto never used to be like this, but now it's become a war zone. And I don't know where all this Black man anger is coming from. I know that men are targeted, you know, as by pedophiles and all of that, the whole nine, just like women are, females are, if not worse, because those real freaks, they want men. That's what they want. They want little boys, and little boys are like, that's what they, you know. Oh my goodness, this is just, I don't get it. I don't get it. But you guys are going to have to start talking and not yelling at us. You're going to have to start really understanding and realizing, like, when this whole sleeping with the enemy thing is very real. Everywhere you look, there's proof of this. You give your money to her and her family and her people. You put nothing back into the community. You blame everything on us. We're either too angry or too fat, or our hair is fake, or our ass is fake. Like, women, what women do is women try to become more womanly for the man. And if the white woman is a standard, then a lot of women who don't feel who don't feel, who don't have a lot of confidence, feel they have to be what they figure you want, which is a white woman. Now, this is why I've been celibate for so long. Also, you know, aside from the fact that I'm very cerebral, I see no reason, no purpose to put myself out there for any of you. Like, really, it just feels like I'm putting myself at risk. And it's happening here in Toronto, because I know my sisters and all are dealing with this kind of thing, but it has to, when is it going to end? When is all this madness going to end? I don't see it ending. I just see us ending. And black women are going to continue becoming, we have to be strong. We have to continue forging ahead. And if it's without you, then it has to be that way, because I know that I'm not going to fail or falter or stop or pause until you get your shit together. Pardon my language. Until you get your act together. I'm not going to. I can't. That just means that's suicide for me. It's suicide for my child. So we can't stop. And it's not that we've been given anything over you. And if we have, we are willing to share. We always have been. You know, you're getting us, you're getting women pregnant. You're still going and you're pursuing these women and making false, giving them false hope and making promises and stuff that you're just not keeping. And then you're blaming the women for it. You know what? Enough. Enough already. I'm not blaming you right now. I'm saying, what is it? If you see this video, I would love for you to say, to tell me, black man, what is it? What is your problem? What is going on? Why are you flipping the script and sleeping with the enemy and putting us all at risk here, including yourself? Because you're not treating the enemy's woman any better than you're treating us. You're just abusing everybody. And it's just become a nightmare. It's become a nightmare. Like, I just gotta eat. I'm eating my feelings. Okay, not candy anymore. Salad this time, I'm trying. Okay, I had chocolate cake, two big pieces of chocolate cake today, but I deserved it, I worked for it. But I'm just trying to figure you out. And as for that person, I'm gonna come at you really hard and really fast if you don't unsub me, and I mean it. I'll put you out there like a hoe, okay? I'll treat you what you're being passive aggressive. Is what you're doing. You're being passive aggressive, and you know what I'm doing on the other side there. It's not in any hopes or prayers for you to charm me or whatever. I'm doing that because that's good practice for me. I'm in the music industry, and promotion is something I've done for decades, and it's just a part of what I can do instead of getting out there as a musician myself. And you know who you are. You know who you are. On that note, as usual, I have something to cook or order even. I don't even know if I like cooking. I don't even know if I do. I'm exhausted. I'm just exhausted. Anyhow, you guys have a good day. Have a good evening. Be blessed. And black men, please try and look at yourself with worth. Okay? Stop being sex monkeys for these people who don't love you, who hate you, and just see you as just a pet. Okay, I'm sweating now. It's time to go. Anyhow, like I said, have a good evening. God bless you all. Inshallah. I hope your day, your life, your mind, whatever, gets right. Inshallah. I hope. I pray. I don't know. I don't know what to say. I don't know what else to say. Brothers, just get it together. Please, please, for us. For your own sake. Have a good evening.